So a little bit about us. We work for Yahoo, and we actually write Spark in Storm. That is our day job. So we're not really at the higher level of running things on it. It's more that we provide it as a service to other people. And we do more than just Spark and Storm. As you can see, there's Hadoop that we've been dealing with, a little bit of Tez, but that's pretty much what our day job is. So we did drive up here. If you want to.
Okay, so we're down in Champaign, Illinois. We are in the research park of the University of Illinois. We're currently building a new building, which is the picture here. So right now we're in a shared building, but around about December we should be moving to our own building. The site down there is made up of the Hadoop platform team.
Get your mics on now.
Is that better?
Yep.
Hold on.
Okay, the site down there is made up of the Hadoop platform team, and then there's advertising and data platform. And the advertising and data platform is probably about twice the size of the Hadoop team. And basically, as the Hadoop platform team, we kind of provide it as a platform for everybody else in Yahoo to use. So like Bobby said, we actually write the Hadoop code and the Spark code and Storm, and then there's other people that use it.
We are hiring. You know, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. That's partly why we're here, to try and let people know that we're hiring, we're growing, we're looking for more people to help us out with this. So,
okay, so I'll give you a quick overview of Spark in case anybody isn't familiar with it. So originally, actually, Spark is a framework where you can write programs in terms of transformations and distributed data sets. So the RDDs, or resilient distributed data sets, is one of the key concepts, and it allows you to spread across the data, spread your data across the cluster, store it in RAM or in disk. So you can choose whether you want to keep it in RAM if it's small. If it's not big enough to store in RAM, you can split it across RAM and disk, or just in disk only. It allows you to do all these things in parallel. You describe them as transformations. You want to do a map, a filter, and then it also supports, if a node goes down or you lose an executor, it'll rebuild. It knows how to rebuild that RDD. So as I kind of said, operations are in transformations and actions. Transformations are things like maps, filters, group bys. And it's kind of lazy in that it won't actually execute anything out on your executor's nodes until you actually do an action. So up until then, it just builds up a day schedule of how it's going to schedule things. And then when you run an action, it's when it actually goes out to an executor and runs things. Actions include things like count, collect, save HTTPS. And you can store things, either in HDFS, any type of storage, really. Okay, so here's just an example of working with RDDs. So you have an RDD you created from some file. In this case, it's reading a text file from Hadoop, from HDFS. You're going to do some sort of transformations on it. So you want to do, in this case, a filter. You're looking for lines with Spark in it. And at this point, it still hasn't executed anything. It's just building up how it's going to actually schedule it and run it. And then you perform some action on it. So in this case, we're going to count lines. And at that time is when it actually goes out and executes something on the executors and returns the result. Okay. Spark supports different languages. It supports Scala, Java, Python. Here's one example of a Scala implementation of word count. So it's pretty compact, as you'll see. And what this, again, is doing is just reading a text file, hamlet.txt, from HDFS. We're then taking that, which is an RDD, calling flat map on it, and splitting the lines on a space. We're then mapping each word to word comma one, and then we're reducing by the key. Basically, we're just counting all the words in there. So how this actually happens, again, you have 2B OR, it gets split up into spaces, and by spaces to 2B OR, the map maps it to the word comma one, and then the reduce by key does a shuffle and reduces everything to your final value. So Spark supports multiple different things. It supports the normal programming language that I just showed you. It supports Spark streaming. It also has a Spark SQL, which is kind of like a competitor to Hive. And so here's one of the Spark streaming examples we have for word count. So starting. So this is basically the same thing as word count on Spark streaming. So the socket text stream is opening up a stream, and here we're taking those lines, we're flat mapping it, and we're splitting on spaces, and then those words we're mapping to word comma one, and how you actually start it is with the word stream update stream by key, passing in the update function, and here the update function is holding the values to basically get the current count. You get the previous count from the state that is stored, and then you sum them together. And to actually start it, the SSC start here starts it, and then you just wait for it to come in. So Spark can run on multiple different platforms. It runs on Spark on Yarn, which is what we actually kind of get the port to. That's what we run internally. You can run it on Mesos, and it has a standalone mode also. So depending on how you want to deploy it. I'll let Bobby take the Storm part.
Okay. So Storm has some very different concepts compared to Spark. Storm is built around stream processing. And so there are several concepts with that. So there's a stream, which is an unbounded set of tuples that just come in one at a time. There's a spout, which is going to be something that produces a stream. So this may be pulling things from Twitter, from Kafka, from Flume, you know, whatever it is that you want to be processing. And then you have bolts. Bolts will do the actual processing piece. So they'll do filters, aggregations, joins, whatever it is. And finally, you end up with a topology. A topology is a collection of these bolts and spouts to process something. Oftentimes it's a DAG, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. You can do cyclical processing that supports that. The architecture is fairly simple. We have one part which really deals with control. So you have Nimbus, which is the master node that does scheduling and it decides where to run things, and that's what you interact with when you want to kill a topology or launch a topology. It's more or less stateless. All the state is stored in Zookeeper. So that if Nimbus goes down, it can come right back up. Maybe you couldn't launch a topology for a little while, but everything keeps running. Then there are several supervisors. Supervisors, if you're familiar with Yarn or Hadoop, they're similar to the node manager or to the task tracker. Their job is to launch workers. And they get their data from Zookeeper, and so they're stateless as well. And then there are workers. And workers are the things that actually implement the topology. And they will open up the connection directly to each other. So Storm, for the most part, provides you a framework and then gets out of the way of the data flow. So here again is the word count example, button Storm. So we have a builder, which is very similar to cascading. And so we'll have, and this is in a micro batch in this case. Storm supports both microbatch and non-microbatch. Trident is the API for doing microbatch. So we declare a topology. We're going to create a brand new stream that is coming from the spout. I didn't include the declaration of the spout here. There are lots and lots of different spouts that come fairly standard with it. And then for each of those, we're going to pull the field out of the tuples called sentence. We're going to split it and produce a new field called words. And then we're going to group that stream by each of the words. And then we're going to do a persistent aggregate. And what that does is it's going to take this count function and aggregate all of those fields that were in that micro batch with the count. Then it's going to take what was stored previously for that batch and aggregate it again with the count, and then store it back in. In this case, we have a state store that is set up for in-memory processing, just because it's an example. But it can be any NoSQL store you want that can do key value pairs. And so they have stuff for HBase, for Cassandra, for just about anything, you name it. And so the processing happens pretty much the same way. You get once the first tuple is going to come in, that's just a sentence, it's going to be split apart and be in one bolt, and it's going to get the ones associated with each of those, and then it's going to, in the group by, they're going to be split apart and then finally stored. And then when the next batch comes along, it'll do pretty much the same thing and update the counts. Now, really what you're interested in is, you know, when do we use one versus the other at Yahoo? And so a lot of it for us is picking the right tool for the job. And we actually have quite different concerns than a lot of you in that our scale is actually very different from a lot of other people's. So there are a number of things you do need to consider that we at least consider when we're recommending different solutions to different people. And so some of this is the scale that we're going to be running at. That's not just how much processing you're going to do, but how many tuples, how many megabytes per second type things that you're processing. The latency, the end-to-end latency SLAs that you have. There's also whether you're doing iterative processing. Are there any alternatives that you can do to that? And then they're the more standard ones. If you already know Scala and you like Spark and you're already using Spark, maybe you don't need Storm. You got to use what you know. You got to be able to have code reuse. There's a lot of things. If you're familiar with the Lambda architecture, that's one of the big drawbacks to that, is you don't necessarily get as much code reuse as you do in other cases. And then there's also a question of maturity. We started using these quite a while ago. And so when we started, Spark streaming barely existed. It wasn't very mature. And so for the most part, we've actually standardized on Storm, but we're rethinking that decision in a number of cases. When we use Spark, you want to?
Sure. So the main use case we started out Spark was machine learning. So we didn't. There is really no other solution that we have for machine learning for iterative processing. Right? We have Pig and MapReduce for ETL stuff. We had already kind of looked at Storm for. We had done the evaluation of Storm versus kind of Spark early on, and Spark streaming wasn't really there yet, so we had chosen Storm. But machine learning, you know, people had things hacked up on MapReduce, but it wasn't very reliable and it wasn't very good. So for the machine learning stuff is really, really what we chose Spark to do. And in general, we have had, since we started pretty early on with Spark, we have had some scaling issues. And generally those are like in the terabytes of data. There's lots of people working on these right now, but when we tried it for ETL, probably in like the Spark 0.9-ish version, it just didn't scale very well. Part of that was the way we were using it. So in the past, Spark has been more small clusters with lots of RAM. Well, in general, on Yarn, we run lots of machines, not as much memory. So there are some issues with like shuffle. And those are actively being worked on by actually lots of people. We had also tried Shark, which is basically Hive on Spark. And again, for queries with very large data, it wasn't performing as well as Hive. So again, I mentioned it's kind of like, in the past, it was like 1 terabyte of data or so. I mean, that's kind of just a roundabout. It's definitely harder to use than just like straight MapReduce, which is one problem the ETL guys had. You have to do a lot of tuning. It's much more powerful, and you can do a lot of things with it, but it also takes more tuning to get exactly what you want. again, there's lots of people working on these issues. This Spark is still relatively young, and they're improving. As I think Bobby mentioned, the Spark streaming is micro batch, so the latency is around 1 second, be the smallest. And streaming has a single point of failure still. There is actually a Jira out there to work on kind of a solution for that. And all the streaming inputs are replicated.
Okay, so for store,
What's the question? When you mentioned machine learning, are you at liberty to kind of describe what that use case a little bit more detail?
Well, we use machine learning.
Question for everybody.
So the question was, can we describe in a little bit more detail the machine learning use case? And so we're part of the platform team. And so we work with another team on the platform to be able to provide generic machine learning tools at scale for Yahoo. And so they're looking at different things like GPT, but also streaming things, online learning, like Alpha Wabbit, which was invented at Yahoo, and gradient descent, and some of these other things, to be able to provide it in general. So if you like, look at Flickr. Every time that you upload an image to Flickr, it's getting auto-tagged. And we've gone through and helped them with their deep learning, and we're in the process of trying to expand that out to more things in the company. But through their deep learning method, which is a very deep neural network with all kinds of complicated training that I don't completely understand, we're the system side that kind of says, okay, this is slow, we can improve it this way. And so we're working with other people to be able to expand that out to more of the rest of the company and provide these things. Machine learning, we're looking at using it in all kinds of different places.
Personalization.
Spam detection. Yahoo Mail uses a lot of things for spam detection. We use it for personalization, targeting of ads, ranking of search results is in there, I believe. Just lots and lots of different things. So it's fairly evenly, well. So the question is how much is real-time machine learning versus batch? Traditionally, most everything that we've been doing has been batch on the machine learning side, at least in the training side. That we'll train things in batch and then deploy them out somewhere where they'll typically be used in an online case, whether that's directly in the web servers or something close to that. We're moving much more towards doing online machine learning. And so if there are things that have changes that happen quickly with trending, then we want to be able to react to those changes quickly. So again, that kind of fits in with where we target Storm for. And so Storm is for things where we want, its sweet spot compared to Spark or other micro-batch systems is where you have a very, very low latency. Because micro-batch requires you to batch the data, then typically that's a time-series-based batch. And so if you want your latency end-to-end to be smaller than, say, a second, then you need something that's more like Storm. And we use it for all kinds of things. Real-time analytics, budgeting, machine learning, like was mentioned, just about anything. So like the Flickr example. When you upload your image to Flickr, it goes to a Storm cluster. I think it's 5 nodes right now, and that handle the auto tagging of every single image that's uploaded to Flickr in real time and within. And I think it depends on the use case, but it's usually within 3 or 4 seconds that the results end up back in the UI. So we're using it in all kinds of different use cases, but there are a number of issues still that we need to work out. It does have a much lower level API than Spark. And it doesn't have, so Spark has this wonderful time series built in where, because it's doing micro batch usually based off of time, you can say, I want to go aggregate across the last 10 of these and produce the result. You can do that in Storm, but it's not built in, and it's not as easy of an API to deal with. And if you want to do something that's kind of interesting where, say, I do a big MapReduce-like job, and then I want to join that result with something online. Storm doesn't have that built in. You have to do the big MapReduce, the batch batch processing, dump it into some place that then Storm has access to. And it's not as easy to do as, say, with Spark, where I just say, okay, create my RDD that is this data that I just processed, and now use that RDD to join with this other RDD. So the APIs are not necessarily as equivalent.
I have a small comment. Maybe if you can go back to the previous slide. Maybe when we say lower level API than Spark, it's maybe more accurate to specify that you are talking about Spark streaming, because even the other slide is you are mentioning when you recommend Spark. You are mentioning Spark in a broader context. So maybe it's worth talking that our context here is about stream processing, and part of Spark is that piece, which is stream processing. So this way, maybe we have better understanding what are we talking about.
Yeah. So that is a good point. The comment was essentially that for this particular case where we're doing the comparison, this is with the stream processing. The Storm has no batch processing. You can try and hack it together and make it do that with really, really large tuples if you want. I would recommend it. In Storm, you move the data to the processing, not the other way around. And so moving large amounts of data is not something that Storm does very well. In fact, a lot of people, if they are moving large amounts of data, they pass a handle to it. So they'll store the data itself off in some other data store, and then they'll just pass a reference to where that data is. And that ends up being quite a bit faster than trying to serialize out this data and then deserialize it over and over again. So we're going to go on to a couple of fictitious examples to kind of show where you might use one versus the other. And so the first one is a silly little app that is going to track commute time. And we'll let cities or companies or whatever compete against each other for the shortest commute time, longest commute time, greenest commute, you know, whatever. We'll make money, we'll sell aggregate data to maybe governments and advertisers, and we can sell location-based ads. So feel free to steal this. If you do, I just want to show up to a launch party. That'd be great. I don't see anybody doing that, but go right ahead. So again, here, blatant advertising for Champaign-Urbana. If you do want to move down there, you know, you might get this wonderful result that looks something like this. And yes, my commute time is 7 minutes, and that's by bicycle. So it's kind of nice. So things to consider in this case. We want to scale. And so the scale would be ideally everybody in the world. If not, then if you're only doing this for a very small number of people, throw up Oracle, MySQL, you know, whatever else, it's going to be good enough. It's going to handle the load. These tools are really designed for something that is at a very large scale. The latency we want, I want to be able to see a turnaround time fairly quickly. A few seconds would be ideal. And maybe we are going to do some iterative processing in a few cases, especially around targeting or if we're doing trend analysis to see how different people commute over time and how those commutes change. So here's the most basic architecture you'd have. So you get this lovely app that periodically is going to heartbeat in, or it's going to send, you know, some commute information to a web service. We're going to take that data and dump it into Kafka. Kafka is then going to feed some of that data into HDFS so that we can process it offline with Spark to be able to do iterative processing. And then we're going to send most of that data, we're going to send the data live to Storm. This is pretty much the classic Lambda architecture, where in one case, the Storm is, we're going to set it up so it's lossy. We don't care if we lose data a little bit. For the most part, we're just going to be doing some basic aggregations on how many people are commuting, how many people have reported in, how long they've taken over different commutes and different geographical locations and other things like that, and do some aggregates and feed that back. So the app can draw some of those pretty pictures. But maybe we want to do something much more in-depth, and we'll let Spark be able to pull that data from HDFS, do the same thing, get an exact result, later on stomp over the old one. But maybe we want to do something more in-depth. So we want to be able to see how often people commute on rainy days versus sunny days or other things like that. Things that we didn't think of ahead of time, but a data scientist wants to dig into. And so we'll let Spark handle that. And then ideally, in the end, the money goes into my wallet and we're all happy. But this isn't the only way to do it, because the latency that we're dealing with is on the order of seconds. And so I really don't need to have my commute time reported in and aggregated in real time exactly to everybody else. On the order of a couple seconds is probably fine. And so we could easily switch that over to micro batch. And like we were saying previously, Spark does have this issue of some potential data loss. So if the client crashes, they've solved that problem already. You can relaunch the client where it left off. But if the master node crashes, they're still working on HA for that. And then also the way they handle replay in case a node goes down is that they replicate the data twice. But if one of those, if the main node that's receiving the data goes down in the middle of that replication, then the tuples or that piece of information is in the process of reading is lost. It's probably not the end of the world. We probably can live with this because, hey, this is a stupid little app. So we can save a lot of engineering time potentially by just going directly with Spark. And so it will store the data off in HDFS. I don't lose any functionality. I can still do my ad hoc queries later on, and it should work fine. Or maybe I don't really care that much about my ad hoc queries. I set it up the way I want it to be. If I made a mistake, I can always go back and reprocess it because I've stored a lot of that data in Kafka. And so this is what LinkedIn tries to do with their, what they call the Kappa architecture, where essentially the data is stored, maybe I'll store a week or 2 weeks worth of data inside Kafka, and if I need to reprocess that data for some reason, I can bring up a separate topology, pull that data in from the 2 weeks ago, and just keep processing it and stomp over the old data that was there. And so this is another alternative that we sometimes use at Yahoo as well, in that we don't necessarily want two sources of truth, or I don't want the overhead of maintaining two different copies of my processing. If I can guarantee that my processing is going to work with a micro batch system like Trident, then I don't need to write it twice. I just write it once and make sure that my data can be replayed. So another example, the architecture that we've looked at is web scale monitoring. So I want to have alerts when something bad happens. When a node goes down, maybe it's when I'm not processing as many ad calls as I expected to process, something like that. And we also want to be able to provide an interface to people to be able to dig into their data, something more like Splunk, so that they can look at the different trends that are happening over time, compare it against something that happened a year ago, 2 years ago, try and figure out what the best rules are, and then apply those rules to be able to be used in the future. And if you do commercialize this one, I just want a free license, really. Open source would be fine. So again, scale. This is web scale. There's probably going to be lots and lots of different servers, and we're going to be getting lots of different types of data. CPU utilization, memory utilization, disk utilization, network, all types of custom user events from web servers, everything from I serve this thing to maybe even the raw logs themselves, like Splunk. Latency, ideally because I'm alerting, I want to alert as fast as possible, react to whatever is going on. If it's on the order of minutes, that's not going to be ideal. And iterative processing, well, we might be doing some of that if we're trying to dig in to understand what's happened in the past, but we don't really want to be doing anything iterative in the alerting side. And so we get an architecture that looks something very similar to what we had before, slightly different. So we have a bunch of servers that, again, are going into Kafka. You could pick some other delivery system you want. I just picked Kafka because it tends to be fairly ubiquitous at this point. And those are feeding into Storm. Storm would be processing the rules to be able to send off alerts when something bad happens, looking at different things and storing state in HBase, or pick some other NoSQL store you want to be able to know when to send off that alert. But at the same time, we're storing the data in HDFS. both so the UI can have access to that through something like Shark, perhaps, or Hive. Hive is getting support on the back end for Spark as well. To be able to dig into those things and to start graphing older things so I can say, you know, what happened a year ago on this date, or last Christmas when Christmas dinner ended, how did things trend differently compared to this year, or whatever else. There are all kinds of things that tend to be very cyclical and react to different people, and you want to be able to go back and look at these types of things. And so for that, it really makes sense just to be able to use fairly simple SQL-like commands through a JDBC server to go pull these up. But maybe we want to do something that's much more interesting as well. Maybe we want to do some machine learning on these to be able to come up with a model that is going to be able to do a better alerting job than I can do on my own, be able to say, well, this machine died at this point. I don't know what happened to it, but I have all of the disk data and the CPU and all these other things that are associated with it. Maybe this model can actually figure out in the future when a similar machine is going to die, and so I can take it out of rotation and deal with it proactively before I have to worry about an outage. And so being able to do some of that would be very, very valuable. Again, then you can store that into HBase or maybe HDFS so that Storm can take those models and process them in real time to be able to alert. So I think that's about all that we had planned. We're definitely happy to answer questions. We know the internals fairly well. Again, we are hiring, but we won't push that too much more. So, if you do have any questions?
Yes? On that last slide, the UI interaction with Spark directly, what's the nature of that interaction?
So the question was that we have the UI interacting with Storm directly. Really, you just need a feedback path to be able to install rules. And so there are several different ways you could potentially do this. You could take the rule and put it into HBase if it's generic enough. Say the rule is just, I want to filter. And so I just want to know when X happens and then Y happens. And that you can probably just store in HBase. But maybe you want to do something that is much more complicated than that. And so maybe I would actually compile down a brand new topology specific for that and launch that topology. I don't know. I mean, it's some sort of a feedback path. I didn't really think through it that fully. I'm not building this. But you need some sort of that feedback path to be able to say, here is a new rule. I want to be able to alert when this condition happens.
Yeah. Well, when you showed the Storm architecture, you mentioned it's showing Nimbus. But I guess that you are also running Storm on YARN. So what's your experience with running Storm on YARN? Thank you.
So the question is what's our experience running Storm on YARN? We actually don't run Storm on YARN. We have put together a prototype of Storm running on YARN. But YARN currently has a number of issues, especially with security for long-lived processes. So HDFS has, when you turn on security for HDFS, you get a delegation token to be able to go access HDFS. Well, there's a maximum lifetime of that delegation token of a week, 2 weeks, depends on how you configure it. So once that week is up, your processes don't stop running. But if for some reason they crash and you launch a new container on YARN, it's not going to be able to pull in from HDFS any of your distributed cache pieces. And so there's still a bunch of work to be able to make long-lived processes on YARN feasible. And so we kind of left it at that, and we said, let's just concentrate on standalone Storm for the time being. And that's what we've been doing.
Yeah, the reason I asked, because I saw on GitHub like a project like Storm, YARN, whatever, from Yahoo.
And I wrote that, and it is just a prototype. It's a proof of concept, and it's not really meant to be more than that. I know that Hortonworks is working on both Slider, which is intended to be more of a generic piece to be able to bring up arbitrary applications that are long-lived on Yarn. But long-term, what we would like to do is to be able to have Storm be aware that it's running on Yarn, that it doesn't have nodes brought up initially, that it will go off to the resource manager on demand when it needs a node to go run something and request it at that moment. But that's still a ways off. Even the Sansa guy, when we talked with them, they're running on Yarn, but they separate their streaming stuff out completely from the batch processing, so they don't interact with each other.
When you said your selection criteria, a couple of things that you guys didn't do is reliability of both Spark and Storm in maintainability of both.
So, if I heard you right, that you were talking about reliability?
And maintainability.
Maintainability.
Yeah.
Okay, so...
I mean, especially considering that for the most part, people are using both for micro-batches relative to real stream processing, so you can use either one.
Yeah, so the question is reliability versus and maintainability, one versus the other. For the most part, what we use Storm for is actually stream processing. We don't do a ton of micro-batch with Storm. Most of what we're looking at is doing analytics, and so if we're off by a little bit and we drop a little bit of data, it's not the end of the world. And that's for the most part what we do. We do a little bit of micro-batch. The reliability in Storm has been fairly good with micro-batch. I'm not going to say it's stellar, but I don't get called in the middle of the night. It's usually I can handle it in the middle of the day, so it's not too bad. And we don't have anything running in micro-batch we don't officially have anything running with micro-batch on Spark. We provide Spark to people to be able to play around with, and for the most part they use it for batch processing. We have talked to a few people and we have played around with it a little bit, but nothing too terribly significant at this point.
In one of the architecture diagrams you got up there, you had your web server or web service going directly to Spark. Was there any particular reason why you skipped using Kafka in that example?
So the question is, in this picture, is there any reason we skipped using Kafka? I kept putting Kafka in and taking it out again and didn't really... So you can go directly to Spark. It does support that. I don't know how well it supports that. Really, but you could put Kafka in. Kafka just kind of felt a little bit like overkill at this point to store it once and then store it again. And it wouldn't really buy you that much because of the replay in Spark is very different from Storm.
So what about in the use case where Spark crashes and your web service has nowhere to send its data?
Yeah, that would be better. I agree. If Spark crashed, then yes, you'd want somewhere.
You did say that it has the potential to, right?
Everything has the potential to crash.
Well, as a single point of failure.
When I talk about a single point of failure, so I'm talking more about data loss where you can't recover. So if the master node goes down in Spark, then it stops processing batches, and you have to bring it back up. And it has lost all the state of all the RDBs before it, so you have to start over from scratch. If the client crashes, they do checkpointing to HDFS. And so if it crashes, you can relaunch it fairly quickly, and it will start doing micro-batch processing again where it left off before. So there are different pieces, and when things crash, they crash differently. So yes, having Kafka in there would probably be preferable. I agree.
Sure. So I'm most familiar, so I actually did the security in Spark, and the main purpose was for Spark on Yarn. So that's where the authentication is the most secure, and basically it's using Hadoop to transfer secret keys and stuff like that. So right now it's basically just basic authentication, It doesn't support like SSL. All your normal internal Spark connections are secure. With Kerberos? Yeah, well, so if you're using secure HDFS with Kerberos, then yeah, I'll take that back. So internally, between Spark components, so like between the driver and executors, all it's using is a shared secret key. And it's using digest MD5 to type back. It doesn't use SSL or anything like that. You need Kerberos to access secure HDFS. And all that, like on yard, is passed around and handled for you. Now, in like standalone mode, it also has authentication, but the secret key has to be shared between all the daemons and all your applications. So it's not nearly as secure. So if you have applications that on a shared cluster that shouldn't trust each other, then that's not going to help you.
So the question is where would you get the drill down to be able to get these things in depth? So, again, I haven't built this, so I don't know for sure where all of that would be, but kind of the concept that I was thinking would be that Storm would be doing the alerting, and maybe it would be doing some aggregation to be able to draw the graph right now as to what it is. But if you wanted to drill down in depth as to what was actually going on, you would go talk to Spark. Because Spark would have all the raw data right there for it to access, and that would allow you to do the drill down and also the historical comparison. Lots of questions. I think you were next.
Yeah, going back to the maintainability and liability aspect, can you talk a little bit about how you have the infrastructure implemented down to like detect things like
okay, so as far as reliability and maintainability, for us when we're monitoring for, so is this for Storm, is this for Spark, is this for both?
Actually, I
assume
you're using similar approaches,
or maybe not. So they are somewhat similar. So for Spark, we run primarily Spark on YARN. So it's going to be YARN detecting that something went down along with Spark detecting. I don't know if Spark has separate detection with the heartbeats. Yeah, so Spark has heartbeats, and when the worker process, executor process, I gotta get the terms right. When the executor goes down, then the heartbeats time out and it realizes it has to relaunch something. But at the same time, YARN as the supervisor, not the supervisor, the node manager, the node manager is monitoring that process. As soon as that process crashes, it recognizes it, it's going to heartbeat into the resource manager, and in the 2.0 version, the resource manager is going to try and inform the AM that this container has disappeared. Storm is similar. Storm isn't running on YARN, but it does have the same sort of concepts. So the workers are heartbeating in through Zookeeper, very regularly. It's actually every 10 seconds or so. They're heart beating into Zookeeper, so they're writing a new state into Zookeeper saying, I'm still alive, these are my statistics. But the supervisor is also watching that process. And the moment that process crashes, the supervisor is going to try and respawn it. If it's unable to respawn it, or if Nimbus doesn't see it running for 30 seconds, it's going to reschedule it somewhere else. And then another supervisor is going to bring it up. So it is very similar concepts with heartbeats, but they aren't exactly the same. One of the things I'm very interested in with Storm is being able to detect slow nodes. So like with Hadoop, you have speculative execution. and they can detect that, oh, something's going to be, something might look slow, so I can launch something in parallel, and if it wins, great, if it doesn't, oh well. The storm is online, is live, I can't necessarily have two things racing each other in parallel. Maybe I can, I need to think about that a bit more. But being able to detect that this node looks like it's slow, it's not dead yet, but it's dying, and then preemptively move things around to someplace else. So if you look at a disk, when a disk dies, it doesn't just suddenly stop working. The disk controller is going to do its darndest to make sure that if I can get the data to you, it will. And so it'll retry 100 times, possibly, to be able to read that data off of the platter before it sends it back. And so you sometimes get these situations where things are going along fine, but one node is just much, much slower than everybody else. First question is scalability, and the second question is heterogeneous versus homogeneous hardware. And so, for scalability, that's one of the things we're working on for Storm right now. Zookeeper tends to be the bottleneck because everything's writing into Zookeeper. There's this hidden feature in Zookeeper where you can turn off flushing to disk. It increases the possibility of data loss, but that really is only going to happen when you have power outage to all three nodes at the same time. So we turn that on, and then in the 0.9.3 release, we've added in some other things to do less writing and to do more compression. And on gigabit Ethernet, we have simulated 2,000 nodes. We actually want to get to 4,000 nodes. Build a 4,000 node storm cluster by the end of next year. I don't know if we'll really fully get there, but that's the plan. So as far as scalability on Storm, and there's a bunch of things we have to do with scheduling to make sure that that's done right. Storm does some kind of dumb scheduling right now, so we want to make sure we aren't hopping across racks and all kinds of other things. So there's still a fair amount of work to make sure that it's going to run smoothly at that big of a scale. So that's where we're at with scalability on Storm. For Spark, it kind of varies a lot on what you're doing. Oftentimes, Spark really likes big, beefy, relatively few big, beefy nodes with lots of memory. And so if you look at the graphs, it can scale to support many, many more nodes. We've done 600 or even 1,000 nodes in a cluster. But after about 200, especially on our less beefy, less memory-intensive nodes, the performance starts to degrade. So it's faster to do smaller than bigger. And again, that varies a lot. There are lots of people actively working on making sure that it can deal with enough data that it doesn't all fit in memory, that it can spill to disk, and things like that. So do you have anything to add on?
Oh, that's it. There's lots of people working right now on Spark, on scalability as far as going wider. I mean, it started out as as a college or Berkeley, and you know they had smaller clusters with more nodes or more memory. So now people are trying to do like us, we're trying to go wider, where we have 4,000 node yarn clusters but with less memory. So there's lots of people actively working on that.
Yeah. And as far as heterogeneous versus homogeneous, yarn and I think Spark support that fairly well. That you can say that I want this many executors or whatnot to run in one place versus another. Yarn natively has CPU scheduling and memory scheduling to be able to support that. And you can declare for each node manager, this is how much memory or CPU I want this to be able to export.
Can you define the number of workers
in Storm? So you can define the number of workers in Storm. And so for each individual one, I can say I want at most two or three workers for this. But Storm doesn't support, at this point, limiting the amount of CPU or memory that an individual worker has. And so we have run into a lot of situations where somebody decides, well, I need a whole bunch of memory to be able to run this. Well, if you take the total number of workers and divide the total amount of memory by them, I'm sorry, there are certain use cases where you might blow up. And we found that on EXT4 with RHEL 6, there are certain situations where the out-of-memory killer can corrupt the file system, and it takes a long time to come back up. So we yell quite loudly at people when they go over. But in response to that, we have a prototype right now where we have added in memory and CPU-aware scheduling to Storm. So that for an individual bolt or spout basis, you declare, this is going to use a whole lot of CPU and not very much memory, or this is how many megabytes of memory I want reserved for this particular bolt instance. And then it will figure out on your behalf how much heap should be running in the JVM, reserve some off heap for you if, say, you're doing Spark, shell bolts or shell spouts or something else that is not accounted for in the heap, and provide that ability to you. We haven't released that as open source yet. We plan on doing it soon. We want to make sure we've worked out all the bugs and things with it first. Yeah, so it is a pain that we felt, and we're trying to address it. It's just not completely ready for prime time yet. We had an intern over the summer from UIUC who put it together and did a great job, but we want to make sure that it really is ready to go before we do too much more with it. Yeah. What type of data visualization tools? We don't actually do too much with data visualization. We provide Hive Server 2 so that people can get access to their data. I think some people use Tableau. I know that like on the advertising side of things, there are a whole bunch of custom tools that people have written to be able to draw pretty graphs and things. We're more concerned with just making the back end stable and available to people, that they draw their own pretty pictures. Oh, sorry,
yeah,
I'm ignoring the people over here.
Can you think of any use cases where it's actually important to have a quote single event update as opposed to a micro batch with a short time limit?
So are there any use cases where a single event update is?
Or that which Storm does, as I understand, is important over just having a micro batch with a short time limit?
I think it really depends on the time window. So there are some use cases that are much more like distributed application servers. And so I know the guys at DataTorrent quite well. I used to work with them. And they've told me that a lot of their customers tend to use their product, which is very similar to Storm, as a distributed application server. So somebody comes in, and in real time they say, I want you to compute the reach of these tweets, for example. And that's what Twitter used Storm for initially, was to be able to have people interact with it directly. And that is one use case that I think is a little bit harder to do with a really short time window. It's not impossible, but it is more of direct latency from when one thing happens to when the result is returned. And it's not, I don't think there's anything that you can't do with micro batch, because you can always make the batch a size of one. And then they're essentially equivalent. So it's more a question of, is the overhead associated with that worth it compared to something that is doing, it's more a question of the trade-offs with the overhead.
Yeah, I have, could you please bring back slide 21? Yeah, it's more a comment than, it's a comment more than a question. As you mentioned, this is a typical Lambda architecture, so it's fun here to note that in this case, like Spark is playing is on the batch layer, so that's really funny, because they are selling it as a something which is speedy and fast.
Well, it is speedy and fast. It's just a question of I mean, yeah, it is speedy and fast, and it's more a question of how much data you have, and honestly, it's not so much the question of how long it takes to do the computation, it's more a question of HDFS, and how many files HDFS is going to be able to support you writing in at a single point in time. HDFS does not like small files, so 1 second files probably doesn't make a lot of sense. It's probably going to be more on the order of a minute file minimum. And so that's kind of where it fits in more, is more the area between Kafka and HDFS rather than how long it takes to process something once it's in HDFS. Yeah.
Okay. It wasn't clear to me. I'm curious whether with Storm you can do something like recursive estimation or a Kalman filtering or some application where you need to have where you have a state that's continuously preserved and you want to be able to ask it what the current state is and new data flows in that revises the state. Is that sort of application possible? I know you can do this with Spark streaming, but it wasn't clear to me whether. So is my question clear?
Yeah. So the question is, can you do something where you're continuously updating the state? And you kind of have to. That's most of what Storm. Yes, Storm can continuously update the state. Oftentimes, what Spark says that they're going to be faster at this because all the state that you have is stored in RDBs. And so in the common case when nothing fails, you're only interacting with memory and everything's great and it's incredibly fast. And if something does fail, then you recover. Storm doesn't offer that same sort of recovery. So if you keep stuff in memory, then you have the potential of data loss. And so typically what happens is you want an external system that you're going to store it in. And oftentimes there's going to be a NoSQL store like HBase or Cassandra or whatever else. But I know plenty of people who use Memcached or Redis and just say, I know there's the possibility of data loss, but these things are so stable and so solid, I'm not going to worry about that too much. And so the Storm kind of hands that off as an external system.
Okay. The partition strategies of Spark, can you be more specific? So, I mean, Spark reads stuff from HDFS, so you can obviously partition it however you want in HDFS, and I think how you partition is going to be greatly dependent on your application, how much data you have. I'm not sure about the streaming side.
I thought that the partitioning in Spark, because Spark uses the standard input formats that Hadoop uses for MapReduce, and those input formats do partitioning. It's built into them, and so it's really user-defined how that partitioning works. You can decide how you want to partition your data. And then if you get it wrong to start out with, you can always do a custom grouping or whatever else to then move the data around to where it needs to be in a new RDB to partition it that way. I don't know more than that. Oftentimes there is graph partitioning because it's going to be built with the graph input format. For the streaming RDBs, I don't know if there is a way to really partition it beyond just impact.
Yeah. Are you going to be referencing a word control in Spark? It's very compact and precise. Is there a way you can pull the thread if you write a Scala application that uses Spark?
You can, within a Spark program, if you can fork a thread? Well, I mean, Spark has something called pipe, which is kind of like Hadoop streaming, where you can parallelize something and run pipes on that data set. I'm not sure if that's exactly what you're looking for.
What you're getting at is basically you've got a stream coming from F on the data set. The stream coming from Kafka that reads the storm, right? So what is the data in each case, right? So let's say there was a storm next to it, where you're indexing data at the same time. So you have streams coming out of storm, going in two directions at the same time in the process parallel way. So can I implement the same model within Spark, where I can come into two destinations at the same time?
Yeah, you can take your RDD that you've created, and in one line say, I want to filter it this way, another line you filter the RDD a separate way, and then you do the two runs that say, I want to write this out to wherever. And I believe both of them will be running in parallel at the same time. I don't...
Yeah, they have parallel RDDs. I haven't done a lot with them, so...
Because if you write your statements, they're going to execute in sequence of fashion. But those statements will be executing one after the other. So I was trying to think if I can form a thread and say I must have this process coming by one thread.
So if you look at the way that Sharp was written originally, that essentially it was that you had a single shared context and each of them were processing separate threads that were interacting with that context separately. And the RDD was shared among them. I thought there were a few issues that they had to work out as far as threading, but I thought most of those were solved. So I think that is possible. I don't know for sure, but I think it is.
Can I rephrase the question? Because that brings up an interesting point. With Storm, you can build these topologies, which are graphs. The question is, do you have as much freedom to build topologies in Spark? Like you were giving the example of a topology where you split it into two different parallels. Yeah, can you think as general a topology is Spark and it's
I think you can, or at least you can come very close to that. The difference is how the processing happens, like you said. That if I say do this processing and return the result, then it's going to do that processing in the background and return the result. And then if I want to react in a different way, I say do some different processing and return the result, it's going to do that processing separately. So the stuff isn't necessarily happening in parallel, but because it's all micro-batch, their concept is that I'll do a bunch of micro-batches. I'll do my batch processing very quickly and devote all my resources to this one set of processing I have. As soon as it's done, the client will respond to that and then say, okay, now run this other part of the DAG, do that processing, get the result, and then I'll go back around and potentially do that again. That's what Spark Streaming does.
Is it manual or automatic?
Well,
can you describe the whole DAG and just let it go?
The way it works right now is you describe a DAG, hand it off to the master and you say, run this to completion. And when it's done, then you go back and say, do this again. At least that's how I understand it.
Okay. I'll do two questions, but they're both really quick. One, have you tried Tachyon? And if so, could you get it to work at all? And two, you mentioned the cluster simulation tool that you use, and I'm curious what that is.
So the first question was, have we used Tachyon? I assume you're referring to it with Spark. So we haven't tried it personally, but there is a group within Yahoo I know using it with a Sharp cluster, and they said they've had good results, but I don't know the specifics of that.
And as far as the simulation, we had 400 physical nodes that I launched 10 supervisors on each in parallel and pretended that, and then launched some little tiny JVMs that did nothing. And so it wasn't an official simulation tool. It was more looking at how much load can we put on Zookeeper and whether it's going to fall over when that happens. Or how much load are we going to put on Nimbus when it's downloading data and see if it falls over. So it wasn't an official simulation tool. It was more of
a
distributed denial of service attack on Zookeeper.
All right, one final question.
Yeah, I think, if I'm not mistaken, one of your first slides, you weren't too pleased with the ETL performance using Spark. Is that correct?
Or did so when we tried Spark with very large data, meaning multiple terabytes or bigger, we had issues. And this was with Spark 0.9. We had one team who was really interested, and they tried it out, and they basically just had, they're having problems with it, right? It took a lot more configuration, and they're under deadlines, so basically they gave up. And that's some of the stuff they've improved. Like in 1.1, they made a lot of improvements, and they made like the shuffle sort much better. And there's people continuing to work on it.
Yeah.
So was that on HDFS, or you know what was on the back end?
Yeah, it was on Yarn reading HDFS data.
Okay.
But HDFS wasn't the bottleneck. The bottleneck was they brought all the data into memory. And then when they tried to do a big shuffle, the shuffle won't work very well. You had skewed data, so it couldn't spill the disk. This was back in the very early days. And just comparing the performance to, say, MapReduce, it actually was slower in those cases because we had so much data. That's why we tried ETL, but it's not for Yahoo scale. So we do have people who have done some ETL with it on a much smaller scale, but we didn't feel like we could make it the back end for PIG or say, this is something that everybody should use for ETL in Yahoo because it wasn't giving the right numbers. And that's the same for Shark. That we do have people using Shark right now, they have their own cluster to do interactive queries and it's working fairly well for them, but it's on a much smaller scale than something we want to provide to all of Yahoo. So we provide Hive for all of Yahoo. And just about any data size, if it fits in the grid, they can process it. It may take a long time, but that's what happens.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's being retired anyway, right? The Shark, so it's not.
Yeah, it's being replaced by Spark SQL.
Yeah. It's being replaced in two interesting ways. So Spark SQL is replacing it from the Databricks side, but Cloudera and a number of other people are actually putting in a new backend to Hive, which is Spark. And so it's Shark is dead, long live Shark, under a new name. It's just interesting to see how all these different things keep coming up again.
All right, thank you.